So, as for today, we're not going to take long because we're just going to continue the previous content on the autonomic nervous system, by which we're going to continue on the parasympathetic. Okay, so previously we stopped at this slide, right? Betul tak?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, so okay, so as far as I mentioned to you previously, apa dia cakap bukan saya. As far as what we have discussed previously, we know that our system have the somatic, which is we can control voluntarily, and half of it are the things that we can't control, by which we say that it is being activated without our conscious, which is known as the autonomic nervous system. Okay, for voluntary nervous system, for somatic nervous system, we do know when to react. We can say to our brain either we want to react or we don't want to react. But for autonomic nervous system, we do not know because it's going to adjust depending on the stimulus which has been sent, either from the external environment or from the internal environment. For example, either from the changes in the temperature, in the environmental temperature itself, or either changes in the partial pressure of the oxygen itself in your environment. For example, like macam you duduk dekat sekarang ni, dekat bawah ni, dekat sea level ni. For example, that the oxygen concentration is enough for you to breathe in and out normally. But let's say one day you join a team which want to go for the, what do we call, the hiking team, for example. Nak pergi manjat bukit dekat Gunung Kinabalu ke, ha, sekarang tak boleh lah PKP kan. Ha, nak pergi mana-manalah, Everest Mountain ke, for example, Mount Everest ke. And then, we do know that when, for example, like when the height of a certain place is increased, means like increase in altitude, so the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide going to be reduced. So during that time, your body, you do not tell your body that the oxygen level is low, but your body have a sensor by which it's going to detect that the partial pressure of the oxygen at that place is low. Then your body try to activate the breathing process. Okay, your heart rate going to increase, your lungs functions going to increase in breathing, respiratory response, for example, to occupy the needs for the oxygens, the demand of your body tissue and so forth. You do not tell your body, but it's going to go occur itself. And one most important thing, okay, about the sympathetic nervous system, you rarely going to notice that your autonomic nervous system undergo dysfunction until you get a certain symptom. Okay, so contoh-contoh simptom dia adalah dizziness, lightheadedness, okay, sakit kepala, lepas tu apa lagi rasa? Suddenly, like you are sitting, okay, sit on a chair like for a long time, and when you stand up, you start feeling dizzy, for example. You have not experienced that before, but that day you experience it. So it means like there must be something wrong with you. Okay, so the importance of this autonomic nervous system usually not being recognized until it's undergo impairment. So means that when we say that, oh, I say sympathetic is for emergency use, for fight and flight. Meanwhile, for the parasympathetic is for rest and digest, that you say like that. It is very general term. But actually, the sympathetic nervous system is not only used for emergency response, but it's also what do we call involved for your routine activity. Like for example, when you lying on bed, for example kan, pagi-pagi tidur, and then mak kejutkan sahur kan, you bangun, and then you bangun, you terus daripada you supine position, for example, macam, okay. Oops. Okay, for example, like you lying, you are in a supine position. Ini kita panggil supine, eh? Supine positions, and then suddenly you waking up, so your body will try to make an adjustment. So what kind of adjustment your body trying to make? during lying down, your blood pressure is actually have evenly distributed for the whole of your body. But once you standing up, okay, you tahu kan dekat Earth ni kita ada gravity kan? So we do know that on Earth we have a gravity. Okay, we have a gravity. But when you standing up from a supine position, all of your blood gonna be pulling downward because it's being pulled by the gravity. So when you standing up, all the blood going down. What gonna happen to our brain is that our brain gonna deprive of the blood supply. Similarly to our heart. And bear in mind that our heart are actually having a receptor which is known as the baroreceptor. Pernah dengar tak baroreceptor? Baroreceptor. Pernah dengar. Baro tu maksudnya apa?
Pressure.
Receptor lah kan? So, pernah dengar barometric pressure?
Pernah.
Apa dia?
Yang ukur pressure dalam bilik eh.
Dia ukur ketempatan udara tu. Barometric. Contohnya oksigen berapa milimeter mercury. So similarly to our system, kita pun ada sensor juga, barosensor juga. But that sensor located everywhere throughout our body, especially at the carotid sinuses, kat heart kita, and also at your brain. When you standing up, all the blood has been pulling down. So at this region, at the superior regions, is gonna get low in pressure. And then we do know that the integrating center for the autonomic nervous system is located in the hypothalamus, am I right? So this hypothalamus start detecting and telling the autonomic nervous system, especially the sympathetic nervous system, "Hui, your blood pressure is low. Do something." So it's gonna activate the sympathetic nervous system and increase the blood pressure. So we do know that at our cuff over here, kita panggil apa? Betih kering yang you panggil. Cuff region over here, our vein are actually having a valve. Kalau you ingatlah, kita kalau heart awak belajar kan from form 3, if I'm not mistaken, you did learn you have the valve for the heart chamber. What do you call that? Mitral valve, apa lagi valve yang ada? Pulmonary valve, aortic valve and so forth. But similarly to the cuff muscle, they also have a valve. So, and when this sympathetic nervous system has been activated, so your cuff vein, okay, you're going to learn this cuff vein specifically or its name in anatomy class, okay? So, it's going to vasoconstrict. So, why is vasoconstrict? Because it has been activated by the sympathetic neuron, okay? So, once it's activated, it's going to go vasoconstrict and it's going to push all of this blood back to the whole system. And then, all of the body function going to get normal back to the normal situation. Yeah, faham eh? Okay, simple je. Tapi kita kena faham lah. How does it work? Okay, so this is one of the condition. I think we just get introduced this before from previous class. So this what we call as the orthostatic hypotension. So orthostatic hypotension mean ortho means position lah daripada from supine to standing up. Hypotension mean low in pressure. So basically, it's from the sitting down to the standing up position. So how do we classify this orthostatic hypotension? Kita panggil nama lah. Siapa tadi saya dengar nama, rasa macam ada Amirul Haikal. Are you there, Amirul Haikal? Ada tak
Amirul? Yes, saya ada.
Blood pressure kita berapa, Amirul? Amirul ke Haikal?
Haikal.
Okay. So what is our normal blood pressure? We don't have fixed blood pressure, but what is the normal one? Kita ada range lah, but usually what is the value that we set considering normal? Tahu tak?
100 hingga 120.
Bawah? Dia ada atas bawah kan? Apa atas tu kita panggil apa? Bawah tu kita panggil apa? Belajar sikit. Apa over apa? Kenapalah pen saya ni tak respon? Sakit hati saya. Ada. Ui. Ha, 120. Azlin cakap 120 over 80. Ui. Ayuh. Okay. Eh, salah. Teruk betul 180. Dia punya blood pressure. So, 120 over 80. Alright. Pernah tengok tak mesin tu? Blood pressure punya mesin tu. Tak pernah tengok pula kan? So, 180 normally, our blood pressure is 120 over 80. So, this 120, we call it as a systolic, mean contraction. And bawah ni, kita panggil dia diastolic. Okay, boleh ha? So, systolic over diastolic is 120 over 80. But those who the systolic blood pressure fall more than 20 millimeter of mercury and its diastole fall down 10 millimeter of mercury within a minute, we consider it as the orthostatic hypotension. Basically, from sitting down to standing up positions, you're going to take 15 seconds to coming back to its normal blood pressure. Maksudnya sympathetic activity kita tu 15 saat dia dah adjust dah. Duduk-duduk, okay, kita dah okay. But if you are longer than this time, means that there is something wrong with your sympathetic response. Ataupun sympathetic response ataupun another condition lah. We have to check for that. Okay, it's not necessarily only due to the sympathetic problem. Okay, so. Alright. So, we done this. Now, let's move on to the neurotransmitter. Neurotransmitter tu apa? Ada tak? Siapa nak jawab? Siapa tahu neurotransmitter tu apa?
Chemical substance that transmit impulse.
Chemical substance that transmit impulse. Salah ayat dia. Betul chemical substance. But impulse tu benda lain. Siapa yang jawab tadi? Thank you. Betul dah. Tapi impulse tu adalah electrical current. So we don't call a chemical substance that transmit impulse. Kalau kita kata chemical substance transmit impulse, it means that dia submit current. Salah lah. So, it's actually a peptide which act to communicate between one neurons to another neurons or from the neurons to the effector or organ. Okay, it is a neuropeptide. We also call it as a neuropeptide. Okay, so, okay, now let's move on to the neurotransmitter and also the receptor involved in the autonomic nervous system. So, in autonomic nervous system, one of the neurons that available is cholinergic neuron. Okay, do you still remember that I said that in sympathetic nervous system, the preganglionic, this one the preganglionic, preganglionic of first order neuron is going to release acetylcholine. Okay, similarly to the parasympathetic, it's going to release acetylcholine. Okay, so any neuron similar to the somatic nervous system also is going to release acetylcholine. So any neuron that release acetylcholine, we call it as the cholinergic neuron. After that, we call it as the cholinergic neuron. So who are the cholinergic neuron? So the cholinergic neuron are all sympathetic and parasympathetic preganglionic neuron. Boleh? So all sympathetic and parasympathetic, all sympathetic and parasympathetic preganglionic are actually the cholinergic neuron, and similar to the postganglionic for the parasympathetic is actually the cholinergic neuron. Alright, and then we have the sympathetic postganglionic that innervate the most sweat gland and also blood vessels of the skeletal muscle. Okay, this one is the cholinergic neuron. So cholinergic neuron gonna release acetylcholine. And we do know that neurotransmitter is just acting the same as what the enzyme and substrate activity. By which dia sama macam, dia panggil apa? Key and apa? Saya lupa term dia. Yang enzyme dengan substrate tu, dia panggil apa?
Lock and key.
Saya tak tahulah mangga dan kunci.
Lock and key.
Saya dah lupa. Okay, so it's just the same like that one. So means that neurotransmitter also have its own specific site to bind. If let's say it is the cholinergic neurons, it's gonna bind to the cholinergic receptor. So in cholinergic receptor, we have two types, which are the nicotinic receptor and also muscarinic receptor. So where does they get this name? So this name is actually depending on the receptor subtypes. Okay, so the sympathetic, so who are the nicotinic receptor? Are the sympathetic postganglionic neuron and also parasympathetic postganglionic neuron. And similarly to the motor end plate of neuromuscular junction, this one is actually in the somatic nervous system. Okay, and another receptor that we have is the muscarinic receptor. So means that acetylcholine ni dia boleh bind dengan nicotinic, and acetylcholine juga boleh bind dengan muscarinic receptor, but it depends on the location where does this neuron innervated. Innervate, faham eh? Innervate tu maksudnya dia pergi dekat mana? Dia pergi dekat plug mana? Ha, tu maksudnya innervation lah. Ha, dia sambung dekat mana? Alright? Nanti tak faham. That is the correct term for the nerve. So, innervation. So, for muscarinic receptor, it's located at the smooth muscles, cardiac muscles, gland, and also innervated by the parasympathetic postganglionic axon. Alright? So, as far as we concern, how does it going to mediate its action is depending on the where does it activated. If let's say that organ belongs to the sympathetic organ and being response to the sympathetic activations, so it going to cause depolarizations and excitation. Okay? If let's say it's bind to the parasympathetic, for example, like this one. Okay, parasympathetic, kita tahu dia buat apa? Dia reduce kan activity kan? So it going to cause hyperpolarization. So that's how it works. Okay. So instead of just having the cholinergic neuron, cholinergic receptor, we have another type of neuron and another type of receptor, which is known as the adrenergic neurons and also the adrenergic receptor. So bila kita tengok adrenergic ni, kita fahamlah it is actually noradrenaline or epinephrine. Alright? So bila kita cakap epinephrine, adrenergic apa semua ni, kita reflecting to what? Sympathetic or parasympathetic? You selalu cakap, oh, adrenaline rush lah, apalah. So, it is. Siapa nak jawab ni? Ya, Darshini. Sympathetic. Ya, Darshini ada? Ya, Darshini dah study kan? Dah study kan, ya, Darshini?
Yes, doktor.
Okay, tak ada. Itu je nak tanya, nak dengar suara je. Okay, so adrenergic neuron is basically most sympathetic postganglionic neuron. Of course eh, dia memang postganglionic eh. Ni adrenergic ni. Sympathetic postganglionic. Dia tak ada dekat parasympathetic ni. Dia duduk dekat sini je. Okay. Sebab apa dia tak duduk dekat parasympathetic? Because both pre and post postganglionic neuron for the parasympathetic is actually the cholinergic neuron. Dia tak release norepinephrine sebab tu dia tak react to the adrenergic receptors. Alright? You understand that point eh? You kena faham. If you understand, then you not get it wrong. You kena faham. Dalam fisiologi, senang je tips untuk terror fisiologi is actually understanding the structure of the organ itself. Oh yeah, before that, I terlupa nak cakap dekat you. When you learn something, especially for anatomy and physiology, okay, when you, because this is a basic one, eh, basic to get to know things. You tak tahu rupa handphone tu macam mana, betul orang bagi awak handphone. And then you tenung, you telik handphone tu semua, and then you get to know the functions of the handphone. Lepas tu bila dah lama you dah terror handphone, baru you tahu kalau handphone you tak boleh tekan dekat mana-mana, you tahu nak adjust kat mana, rosak kat mana. Am I right? So bila dia rosak atau dia rosak, you tahu nak tekan kat mana, adjust nak mana, because you understand the basic mechanism of the phone itself. Means that you already understand about the anatomy and the physiology. Means anatomy, the structures of the phone. The physiology, how does the phone function? But then when your phone undergo a problem, for example, means that the pathology, then you get to know, oh, we can fix this one. Kita repair lah dekat sini. You tak boleh nak tekan dekat sini. Sound tak boleh tekan. Suara slow semua. You do know the function. That's why, before you go and terror your pathology, terror your what? Your disease or what, for whatever it is, you need to terror anatomy and physiology first. But in order to terror physiology, you need to understand the structure of the things. You pernah tanya tak, why God have given you two lungs? why God has given you two kidneys. Pernah tanya tak? Why does your brain is located at the superior portions of your body? You kena tanya lah. You have to query yourself. And one more thing. Why does the lungs shape like that? You tanya. Nanti ya. Bila you nak belajar tu, you tanya dulu. And then baru you akan faham. Oh, dia sebab gini, gini, gini. Kalau lung tu bentuk macam ni, oh, jadi macam ni, macam ni, macam ni, macam ni. Okay, you have to understand the structure first. Then, any structure that got, any structure, any shape, any figure that God has given us in our body is actually related to its function. Sebab apa dia letak brain dekat atas, tak letak brain dekat lutut? Siapa nak menjawab saya? Kita break sekejap. Ada tak nak tanya? Kalau dia cakap kan, tengoklah dengan mata, janganlah tengok dengan lutut. Jangan tengok dengan hidung. You kena tanyalah. Iklan sahaja, tapi you kena fikir secara logik ke macam mana. Okay, so now, kalau saya cakap lah, letaklah mata tu dekat lutut. Barulah nampak batu kat jalan tu, baru tak jatuh. Tapi ada sebab lah kenapa mata kita kat atas kan. Okay, takpelah. Iklan je. Alright. So now let's continue on the adrenergic receptor. We do know that this adrenergic receptor, we have two types. Okay. So adrenergic receptor is specifically made to bind with the norepinephrine and epinephrine. We have two types. We have alpha and beta, by which it effect gonna cause excitation or inhibition. What excitation, what inhibition? Supposedly is excitation, right? Because it is the sympathetic neuron, right? No, because you remember that part of the organ in your body are only innervating. Some of the organ in your body are only innervated by the sympathetic nervous system. So means that the once the sympathetic nervous system is not there, so it's going to reduce its activity. So it's going to cause the inhibition. Okay, so now let's move on to the parasympathetic nervous system. I did mention for sympathetic nervous system, it is thoracolumbar division. But for the parasympathetic, it is craniosacral because it's originated from the cranial and sacral segment of the spinal cord. So cranial ni tadi siapa yang cakap dekat saya? Berwin Kumar ke? Okay, saya tak ingat. Alright, so like the cell body of the preganglionic neuron not only originating from the spinal cord, but can also originating from the brainstem. So the craniosacral, cranial is actually located at the brainstem region. The midbrain, the pons, the medulla oblongata, okay, all of it having the cell body for the preganglionic neuron for the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so its cell body are actually given rise to the cranial nerve number 3, number 7, number 9 and number 10. So it's not only come with its name, come dengan nombor ni je, Roman number je, but it's also have its specific name. And for the parasympathetic neuron, they have the ganglion also, which is known as the ciliary ganglion, pteringopalatine and submandibular ganglion. They have the otic ganglion and also intramural ganglion. So we're going to take a look at this one by one. You can take a look at this is at the midbrain region. We have the parasympathetic preganglionic nuclei. Okay, so this one we call it as the endinger vespal nucleus. So this endinger vespal nucleus going to arise the cranial nerve number 3. For the presympathetic cranial nerve number 3, we call it as the oculomotor nerve. Cranial nerve number 7, we call it as the facial nerve. For the cranial nerve number 9, is known as the glossopharyngeal nerve. And for cranial nerve number 10, is the vagus nerve. Alright, so in the midbrain, they have a specific nuclei by which the preganglionic or oculomotor neuron originating, known as the endinger vespal nucleus. And then this gonna go to RNR, which is known as the ciliary ganglion. Okay, but for cranial nerve number 7, it's gonna communicate with the postganglionic neuron at the pteringopalatine and submandibular ganglion. And for the cranial nerve number 10, it's gonna communicate with the second order neuron of the parasympathetic nervous system at the otic ganglion. And then for the rest of the for the rest of the, what we call the parasympathetic neuron, which is contributes to the majority of the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the cranial nerve number 10, which is also known as the vagus nerve. Okay, it's gonna innervate. They don't have a specific ganglion like this, but they have a ganglion which is we call it as the intramural ganglion. So ingat lagi tak apa maksud intramural ganglion? Kita dah discuss masa last class intramural. Who want to answer me? What does that mean by intramural? We have the paravertebral ganglion. We have the prevertebral ganglion. We have the intramural ganglion. So what is intramural ganglion? Tak boleh respond pasal apa ni. Sekejap. Saya cuba. Siapa ingat? Am I myself? Oh, awak dengar saya lagi. Dengar saya lagi tak? Dengar ya?
Dengar.
Ah, okay. Sebab kadang internet tak dapat. So, awak jangan ya, awak bagi tahu saya. Mesej saya pun tak apa. Kalau tak, nanti saya cakap sama seorang. Okay. So, this one, they are all innervate or they are all communicate with the postganglionic neuron at the intramural ganglion, means that the ganglion is located close to the organ itself or in the organ itself. Okay, so now let's take a look at the vagus nerve number, cranial nerve number 10, which is we call it as the vagus nerve. So this is the vagus nerve, okay, cranial nerve number 10. So cranial nerve number 10 is actually provide 75% of the parasympathetic outflow. So means that semua-semua yang kita ada ni, sini, this one only 25% but this one is 75% of the parasympathetic outflow. Tengoklah banyak mana organ yang dia innervate, banyak kan? Nah, so it is 75%. Okay? So now let's take a look at the parasympathetic functions. You do know that it is actually like the energy reservoir system. Okay, so it's going to reserve all the energy that we consume. It gonna rest and digest everything so that it can store the energy, and it's also promote the reproductive function. Okay, so in the parasympathetic response, we call it as the SLUT, by which the salivation, lacrimation, urination, digestion, defecation, all of these are the parasympathetic response, and they're gonna decrease of what? They're gonna decrease the heart rate. We do know that the heart actually have dual innervation. Similarly to the lungs also, they have dual innervation. Similar to the eyes, they have dual innervation. So means that all of these organs are innervated by both sympathetic and parasympathetic. But once the parasympathetic activation has been activated to the organs, for example like heart, to the lungs, to the eye, to the pupils of the eye, then they're going to cause the reduce in the heart rate, reduce in the diameter of the airways, and also they're going to cause dilations of the pupil. Okay, so alright. So now let's take a look at the first one, which is the parasympathetic neurons that originated from the Edinger Westphal nuclei. So from the Edinger Westphal nuclei, you're gonna give rise to the cranial nerve number 3. Okay, cranial nerve number 3. And then it's going to go to the ciliary ganglion. So what it's going to do? This is very important to learn. Okay? It's going to cause the constrictions of the pupil, by which it's going to reduce the diameter of the pupil, because it's going to focus for the near vision. Okay? Bila biji mata kita, bukan biji mata, you panggil pupil lah kan, yang hitam tu. So it's going to reduce the diameter of the pupil. When it reduces the diameter of the pupil, means that it is response under the bright light. So, kalau you duduk dekat bright light, maksudnya parasympathetic lah yang being activated, dia akan reduce kan? And you're going to focus for the near vision. Okay? Vision jauh-jauh, far vision tu, you tak perlu pun masa you rest and digest. Okay? Bila you perlukan far vision tu, masa awak tengah gelabah. Okay? Being chased by the dog. Then you know where to find a state. Masa awak tadi, you tak nampak pun state. But once your sympathetic activation has been activated, you know where you can get a stick to fight with the dog that chase you. Contoh eh. And then, it's going to cause constrictions of the ciliary muscles and for the nerve vision, which I told you just now. Okay, so you can read this by yourself, just for your reference. And now let's take a look at the cranial nerve number 7. It's originating from the superior salivatory nuclei and also the inferior salivatory nuclei. Okay, from this nerve, what is it going to do? It's going to innervate the pharyngeal-palatine ganglion, dekat sini. Okay, and it's going to cause the lacrimal gland to increase secretion because we know it is for rest and digest. Similarly to the submandibular ganglion over here, okay, it's going to cause the profuse watery secretions also for the digestion process. Alright, now let's move on to the cranial nerve number 9. Sini. So from the cranial nerve number 9, it's going to innervate to the otic ganglion. And what it's going to do? It's going to facilitate the secretions of the saliva. And it's also going to give the chemosensory information by which it's going to detect the blood gas in our body. Alright, by the carotid bodies. And it also give the baroreceptor information from the carotid sinus. It's going to detect the blood pressure. Okay. And then, now let's take a look at this one for the... Okay, for the cranial nerve number 10, which is, we call it as the vagus nerve, which contributes about 75% of the parasympathetic outflow, it's going to innervate the heart, the lungs, the intrinsic plexus of the GI tracts, kidney, liver, spleen, and also the pancreas. But bear in mind, dekat dalam sistem kita, autonomic nervous system ni, okay, this is central nervous system, right? We have left and right portion. Similarly, we have the left paravertebral ganglion, right paravertebral ganglion. Similar to the parasympathetic ganglion, we have left and right portion. For the right vagus nerve, it's going to innervate the SA node. Tahu tak SA node tu apa? Anybody who knows what is SA node? Ingat tak SA node tu apa? Cepat. 9-10.
Atrium.
Hah? Apa? What is it?
Sinoatrium.
Sinoatrium node. Ah, betul lah tu, sinoatrium node. Okay, so what are they doing? Anybody want to answer?
Initiate heartbeat.
Ingat lagi kan, form 3 belajar ni, tak silap saya. So kat matrik pun rasanya belajar lagi. So it is actually the automatic pacemaker in our body. Itu yang denyut-denyut ke jantung awak tu, automatic pacemaker. Alright, so we have two, which is located at the atrium. We call it as the sinoatrium node. And in the left, we have another one. If let's say this one not function, this one kita ada backup. That's why dia ada dua. Kan saya cakap tadi, kenapa benda-benda dalam badan kita ni yang our God have give us only one, why he gave us two. Okay, so this is a backup system, which is the AV node, which is known as the atrioventricular node. Also the pacemaker system. But the right vagus nerve going to innervate the SA node, going to give information to the SA node. Meanwhile, for the left vagus nerve, for the parasympathetic, it's going to innervate the AV node. If let's say you have a problem, this one tak function, dia tak berdenyut-denyut kat sini. Maksudnya, you boleh cakap maybe, bukan confirm dia, you kena buat diagnosis yang lain pula. Maybe it's due to the problem of the parasympathetic activations that innervate to the SA node. So, you cakap right vagus nerve problem. Right? For example, for the lung, it's going to cause constrictions of the bronchial. Okay? For the intrinsic muscle, of course, because for rest and digest, it's going to increase motility and secretory function. And this one, part of it going to be activated and part of it going to be inhibited depending on the autonomic tone. Okay, so we have another portion, which is just now we already talked about the cranial region, but right now we're going to talk about the sacral portions of the parasympathetic nervous system, which is starting from the S2 to S4. Okay, it could be like the whole sacral region. Is going to innervate the structure in the pelvis because the sacral is dekat pelvis kan. So, what are the organ that they innervated? Is the descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum, internal and sphincter. Internal eh, siapa yang jawab external tu, saya dah cakap dah masa first class. Sebab apa you boleh control you punya oh-oh tu? Because it is somatic nervous system. So, it is the internal and sphincter, urinary bladder. Okay, kita belajar di trusa muscle kan hari tu. And also the reproductive organ. Okay, that's why when we say that it's control the reproductive organ, you have to be careful. Eh? Pernah tak main, you duduk, you suruh kawan you duduk, bila kawan you duduk, you tarik kerusi. Ada tak pernah? Pernah kan? Masa kecil-kecil tak tahu kan? Nak main, tarik-tarik kerusi. That one very dangerous because if you make like, if you cause defect at your sacral portion, for example, from lumbar to the sacral portions, habis lawak nanti jadi mandul. Okay, gonna defect the reproductive organ. Okay. Alright, so now the neurotransmitter we did discuss already just now. The neurotransmitter and the receptor for the parasympathetic is cholinergic muscarinic or cholinergic nicotinic receptors. Alright? So you can do this by yourself, it's just for your reference. And this is actually the summary for the whole that we discussed just now. Ini boleh baca eh. Okay, so before that, let's take a look at this for a while. Acetylcholine, the neurotransmitter, is actually a neurotransmitter from the cholinergic nerve terminal. And this is where it's originated, sympathetic and parasympathetic preganglionic and parasympathetic postganglionic. Alright, so instead of that, what we can say is actually the direct ligand gated type. Okay, it can be blocked by the hematonium Cure block at the neuromuscular junction. So this one not going to occur at the parasympathetic, but it's going to occur at the somatic. Dia boleh Cure block at the neurotransmitter junction. Neuromuscular junction, sorry. Neuromuscular means neuron to the muscle junction. Nanti you baca dekat topik MSK yang ni. Okay, so now let's take a look at the norepinephrine. I did mention it is the adrenergic neurotransmitter. This is actually the indirect ligand gated G-protein coupled receptor and it can bind to two type of receptor which is known as the alpha and beta. Okay, so this is what it's going to do once it's activated. It's going to activate the PLC. Okay, it's going to inhibit the adenylate cyclase and it's going to activate the adenylate cyclase. So this is in the opposite manners. Okay, so as far as what we have learned in the autonomic nervous system, we have to know that once the sympathetic has been activated, it's actually going to stimulate the action much longer compared to the parasympathetic stimulation. So the effect is actually last longer. So why does sympathetic last longer comparing to the parasympathetic? So the first one is that sympathetic postganglionic neuron diverges more extensively, meaning that in our body we have vast amounts of the sympathetic postganglionic axon. And one more thing, we do know that the acetylcholine, once it has been released into the synaptic cleft, okay, acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter, right? It's going to be released at the end of the neuron at the synaptic cleft, right? So at the synaptic cleft, we have acetylcholine esterase. So acetylcholine esterase actually gonna like take back the acetylcholine from the synaptic cleft. But for norepinephrine, which has been secreted by the postganglionic sympathetic nervous system, gonna be there for a long time in the synaptic cleft comparing to the acetylcholine, which has been released by the postganglionic parasympathetic nervous system. That why parasympathetic nervous system stimulation is last shorter compared to sympathetic one. Okay, and one more thing, we do know that the sympathetic innervations to the adrenal medulla going to release this epinephrine or noradrenaline into the blood circulation. So from the blood circulation, it's going to take a longer time to be reduced back later on. Okay, so this is just a recap on the autonomic tone. Okay, autonomic tone ingat lagi tak apa? Balancing between sympathetic and parasympathetic. That what we call it as the sympathetic tone or autonomic tone. Okay, so I did discuss this already. Okay, this is what happening, but I did discuss this already earlier. supposedly I discussed it over here. So when you're sitting down, the blood distribution is actually like normalized to the whole system. But once you're standing up, the blood will pull by the gravity. And then the hypothalamus, the heart, the baroreceptor in your body start detecting low in the blood pressure. And then it's going to cause the veins to undergo vasoconstrict. So once the veins undergo vasoconstrict, and the hypothalamus going to send information to the heart so that to increase the heart rate via activation of the sympathetic nervous system, kan? So once it increase the heart rate, once it cause the vasoconstrictions, once it release the neurotransmitter, norepinephrine, it's going to detect, it's going to cause the vasoconstrict of the vessels. Then it's gonna adjust the blood pressure for the whole system. So we have two reasons for the orthostatic hypotension. Number one, and number two already discussed on the autonomic failure due to the diabetes or nerve damage, or what is it? Okay, and the second one is due to the hypovolemic. So hypovolemic means low in volume. Low in what volume? Low in blood volume. Contohnya low in blood volume apa? Contohnya mungkin you kurang hemoglobin, kurang oksigen, boleh juga menyebabkan you pening kepala, dizziness. Alright? And then the stimulations of your body, the sympathetic stimulation of your body start detecting. Or maybe you get involved in the motor vehicle accidents, for example, atau jatuh tangga ke, jatuh pokok ke, and then you undergo massive bleeding. Okay? So we call it as the hypovolemic shock. Your blood going to be reduced, your blood volume going to be reduced too low, and then the sympathetic reflex not effective. Okay, or maybe due to the dehydration. Contohnya orang tu pergi training kan, macam apa, askar training, special force training, berlari sampai sehari tak minum air, and then you're going to go massive dehydration, which can cause hypovolemic. This going to cause orthostatic hypotension. Okay, so maybe because of the antidepressant or antihypertensive drug. So those who have a high blood pressure, for example, they has been like prescribed with the antihypertensive drug. So the purpose of the antihypertensive drug is actually to reduce the blood pressure. But kalau dia tak ambil ikut dosage which has been recommended, it may cause low in blood pressure, causing orthostatic hypotension. Okay, so this is the autonomic dysfunctions that we have. We have due to the disease or due to the injury. Okay, disease ni. You kena tahulah ni, disease dengan injury, sebab orang yang datang dekat you, semua adalah orang yang abnormal. Ada ke orang pergi klinik suka-suka? Tak ada kan, dia rasa sihat lah nak pergi klinik jumpa doktor. Tak ada yang datang semuanya dysfunction. Contoh demam pun dysfunction juga. Ada sakit kepala semua, dysfunction juga. Ataupun dia pergi nak dapatkan MC. Contoh. Ada tu demam juga tu, demam mental nak pergi dapat KMC. Okay, so you need to know the basic function mechanism of our body, then you can understand how does that disease occur. Okay, so for this one, you did learn about the autonomic dysfunctions, then you get to know, oh, this one because of the autonomic dysfunction. Okay, so for example, like we have a primary autonomic failure or secondary autonomic failure. So what does that mean by the primary disease to the secondary disease? Sometimes kita ada primary headache, secondary headache. Oh, dia ada pula sakit kepala pertama, sakit kepala kedua. Dia tak panggil lah sakit kepala pertama, sakit kepala kedua. But call it as the primary means because the failure of the system exactly directly on top of that specific organ itself. If let's say we call it as the secondary failure or secondary due to something, secondary disease, means that it's get a headache due to the other failure system. Contohnya, orang tu diabetic. Dia bukannya ada masalah sympathetic nervous system. But due to the diabetes, it gonna cause the nerve damage. So due to the nerve damage, then they gonna get the autonomic dysfunctions. That's why we call it as the secondary autonomic failure. Yeah? For example, like prolonged bed rest, lama sangat baring. Sebab tu kita tak boleh baring semalam-lama. Seharian nak tidur, tak boleh lah. Prolonged bed rest ni contohnya, orang tu sakit, dekat being hospitalized for a long term. Bila dia nak bangun, kita kena monitor lah. Okay, so, right. So, let's take a look at the features associated with the autonomic dysfunction. Basically, for the cardiovascular features. So, sebab apa kita akan takikardia? Takikardia tu apa? Siapa-siapa tahu tak takikardia tu apa? We have two type. Takikardia, bradikardia. Bukan brandy, eh? What is it? Takikardia, bradikardia. Siapa nak jawab? So, takikardia is actually... Saya bercakap sorang-sorang ke ada lagi ni? Orang dengar saya tak? Dengar, eh? Okay. So, takikardia...
Dengar.
Sometimes internet dia tak ada. Heart rate over 100 beats per minute. Okay. Betul lah tu. So, takikardia is actually increase in heart rate. So, basically, our normal heart rate is actually 60 beats per minute. But it's actually is increase. So, we call... increase more than the normal range, which is we call it actually tachycardia. Kalau dia reduce daripada normal range, we call it bradycardia. Kenapa tachycardia orang yang orthostatic hypotension ni? That because they gonna adjust the hypotension lah. Dia nak increase balik blood pressure, so dia kena activate sympathetic nervous system. So bila activate sympathetic nervous system, what is gonna do? It's gonna increase in heart rate. Okay, so similar to the gastrointestinal features. If let's say their parasympathetic nervous system has been inhibited, dia akan menyebabkan constipation or diarrhea. Maksudnya rest and digest function dia fail. Alright, renal features. Cosmic turition. Turition ni apa? Kuat kencing. Diuresis lah. Or nocturia. Nocturia tu apa? Kencing malam-malam. Incontinence tu apa? Tak boleh tahan kencing. Okay, so renal features. That, and another one, we have the reproductive features. By which the erectile dysfunction, your boys must get to know this. Premature ejaculation or decrease in the vagina lubricant is actually defect in the reproductive features. Okay, so this is a few examples that related with the sympathetic system failure. For example, like in Horner syndrome, Raynaud syndrome, or Buerger disease. So this is actually the Horner syndrome. Basically, we have we have two eyes, right, left and right. Even though these are if left and right, if let's say that you close one of your eye and then you expose only one eye or one pupil to the light, okay? So once you expose to the light, what gonna happen to your pupils? It gonna be constricted. Maksudnya dia akan jadi, the diameter gonna be reduced. But for this situation, it has been exposed to the light. This one has been reduced. But yang ni tak jadi apa? Sebenarnya, even though you have left and right, this left and right are actually interconnected. If this one going to reduce, even though it's only one of these eye are being exposed to the light, this one also supposedly follow. Ha, ni dia tak follow, sebelah je besar. Okay, sepatutnya tak boleh lah. Okay, and then we have the Raynaud phenomenon by which they going to have like a blue extremities because lack of the oxygen supply. Sepatutnya bila lack of the oxygen supply at these regions, your sympathetic nervous system going to send the information to your brain, going to increase the blood circulation. But this one does not occur in here. Similarly to the Buerger disease. So Buerger disease ni dah late stage dah menyebabkan tissue necrosis, mati, putus jari, tak sedar. Contoh eh. Contohnya orang yang lama-lama pakai kasut duduk dekat salji ke apa, dia tak sedar, dia tak rasa kaki dia. So bila tak rasa kaki dia, buka-buka kasut, kaki dia dah putus. Lama sangat, sebulan duduk dalam kasut. Contohlah. Okay. And then we have the Aguirre-Robertson symptom, Aguirre-Robertson pupil, adytonic pupil, Frey syndrome, or Hirschsprung disease. So this is a tonic pupil. Okay, it does not respond. Supposedly, when exposed to the light condition, it's going to reduce its diameter, but it does not grow. Okay, so this is a Frey syndrome. Basically, post surgery, so you akan berpeluh macam tu. Supposedly, tak lah. Macam ni, this what we call as Frey syndrome. And another one, we have a Hirschsprung disease. So basically is a occur in a baby lah, eh. Kalau kita nampak, kalau kita besar ni macam ni, rasanya pecah dah perut kita. So usually is occur in a baby, in a newborn baby. That's why they going to monitor a newborn baby, either they already has passed out, either they already urinate, and then only they can be discharged from the hospital, because they're going to check first whether all of their body system is functioning well or not. But those certain baby, they do not pass out because they have a Hirschsprung disease. So Hirschsprung disease is that dia punya apa ni orang panggil rectum, or dia punya descending colon kat sini ni, sigmoid colon everything, supposedly being innervated by the parasympathetic nervous system. But if let's say it is not being innervated by the parasympathetic nervous system, even though we have like a content to be passed out, so this one is not sensitive because it cannot sense the presence of the stool, for example. So this one gonna go bengkak lah, kan jadi besar, tak boleh nak membuang. So this is one of the example of the hyperparesis. Okay, so is there any questions that you wanted to ask? 9:29 lah.
Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
I want to ask a question. We can control our breathing, right? So is it SNS or ANS?
Okay.
Because breathing is internal, right?
Okay, good questions. Okay, basically our breathing process, kita ventilation kan, kita breathe in, breathe out. Okay, you cakap, oh saya boleh control breathing saya, saya boleh tarik nafas, saya boleh stop, lepas tu tiba-tiba saya boleh hembuskan nafas saya. Yes, correct. You know what, in your breathing process, in your mechanics of the breathing itself, maksudnya proses you bernafas tu, is not only assisted by the autonomic nervous system. Proses you tarik nafas, hembus nafas tu adalah proses mekanikal. Macam mana dia berlaku? Dia akan berlaku dengan contractions of the skeletal muscle first. Okay, what kind of skeletal muscles that located in your thoracic cavity that will assist the respiration? It is the external intercostal muscle. You have internal intercostal muscles. You will learn that in respiration later on, but it's okay. You kena faham dulu macam mana proses tu berlaku. So, the basic idea is, dah saya cerita eh. Saya buka, saya punya video sekejap. Cerita sepenuh hati saya. Nah, saya punya video. Okay. Stop ni. Nampak muka saya? Nampak tak muka saya? Cantik tak saya? Okay. Alright. So, when you breathing, okay, what I'm going to tell you, once you breathing, your external intercostal muscle gonna contract first. Bila dia contract, baru dia akan increase capacity dekat dalam you punya lungs. Okay? So when they increase the capacity in your lung volume tu akan jadi bertambah. Gonna increase in the lung volume. You tahu balloon, macam mana orang buat balloon party tu? Pernah tengok tak balloon party yang orang letak balloon dalam balloon semua tu? They not blow the balloons, like blowing the balloons, put the air in. They suck the gas, dia macam letak balloon tu, dia macam ada container. Macam ni, macam imagine dia macam container, lepas tu dia letak balloon tu dalam container tu. Lepas tu dia letak vacuum tube. Bila vacuum tube tu tarik, that balloon gonna get reduced in the pressure inside, right? So, dia akan create a negative force. Yang negative force tu akan sedut angin masuk. That what is actually happening to our lungs. Ha, similar. Kalau kita tengok, kalau you nak faham fisiologi, you tengok je benda dekat sekeliling you. Dia sekeliling you ni, dia buat berdasarkan fisiologi badan kita sebenarnya. Bukan kita tiru dia. Dia tiru kita sebab kita exist first. Okay? So, the mechanism of the breathing, that why you can control your breathing, why you can still control your breathing is because you control the contractions of your external intercostal muscles. You create the negative forces, then the air in and out. Okay? But normally, for the quiet breathing, is actually the passive process. Dia ada lung recoil and what so forth. Okay? But, even though you can control your breathing, have you noticed who asking me just now? Who's asking me just now?
Me. Pastor.
Siapa nama you?
Oh, Sangeeta.
Okay, Sangeeta.
Sangeeta.
Alright, Sangeeta. You cakap dekat I, either it is somatic or autonomic, am I right? But actually, tapi dia kata, oh kalau saya boleh control breathing saya, kenapa bila saya rendam kepala saya dalam air, buat kontes apa, menyelam, ada a few second je you akan timbul balik. Ataupun you yang paling last kali masuk dekat dalam air tu sebab nak menang kan. Kawan-kawan dah rendam baru you masuk last kan. So, why you can't control that situation is because our pressure, saya cakap tadi, dia ada barometric, dia ada baroreceptor. It's going to detect the concentrations of the oxygen in your body. Dia kompleks sebenarnya, tapi kalau you faham, you akan dapat benda tu as easy, kacang putih je. So, dia ada baroreceptor, that baroreceptor going to detect the amount of the oxygen in your body. If you hold your breath too long, the partial pressure of the oxygen inside your body is going to be low. So when it's low, dekat dalam brain kita, dia ada sensor yang bila low, dia ada, kita panggil, apa saya lupa term tu. dia akan detect dan dia akan automatically jadi automatic nervous system yang akan activated. That's why we can control our lung and we can control our respiration, and at a certain point we can't control our respiration. Boleh? Okay.
Boleh, right. Faham doktor.
Faham. Okay, tapi masa sekarang ni kita tak control kita bernafas, tau. Suka hati lah. Kita suka hati, kita bernafas je in and out. That because it is actually the autonomic regulation. Kalau you boleh control gamaknya tengah-tengah exam tu terlupa nak bernafas, pengsan pula separuh jalan. Kan? So kita ada backup system. Okay. Alright, any other questions?
Doctor. I'm not sure if it is okay to ask this, but can you explain more about slide 51?
Slide 51, sekejap ya. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Before that, saya stop sharing dulu, habis data ya. 51. This one. Nampak ke?
Yes.
Tak nampak. Nampak tak? Oh, ada. Apa yang nak di-explain?
I'm not sure.
Apa yang you tak faham kat sini? What you don't understand about this slide?
About the postgalenic, pregalenic and cholinergic and adrenergic.
Oh, okay. Ni Aida bagi dah tadi. Buih mulut saya cakap. Okay, so dekat this slide, for slide 51, it's going to tell you the differences in the neuron that we have in sympathetic and parasympathetic. This is a summary for this slide and this slide. Nanti you baca, you faham aku eh. Tak apa, before that, Mac saya explain. Okay, so as I said, for the sympathetic, preganglionic sympathetic, ni preganglionic eh. Nampak ke? Saya punya cursor nampak tak? Nampak ke? Tak nampak cursor saya?
Tak nampak.
Oh ya ke? Sekejap saya buka large screen. Okay. Laser saya nampak sekarang.
Nampak.
So yang saya nak explain dekat sini, saya dah emphasiskan dekat sini. So the things that I want to mention here is actually the summary of the neurons and neurotransmitter and receptor associated in the autonomic nervous system. So this one is actually the preganglionic neuron for the sympathetic, and this is the preganglionic neuron for the parasympathetic. Both of these preganglionic neuron is actually the cholinergic neuron. So why the cholinergic neuron? Because they release choline, acetylcholine. Boleh? So when they release acetylcholine, we call it cholinergic neuron. And then we have the adrenergic neuron. Why we call it adrenergic neuron for the sympathetic, for postganglionic sympathetic? Because it release norepinephrine or adrenaline. So we call it cholinergic neuron. Okay. But this one is the type of the receptor. They release a neurotransmitter. So this neurotransmitter must mediate its actions on its own receptor. So what are the receptor that we have? We have cholinergic nicotinic receptor, or cholinergic muscarinic receptor. Boleh? Or we have adrenergic and adrenergic receptor. Boleh? Faham tak? Ada lagi? Boleh ke? Is that answer your questions? Any questions? Any other questions? Dan ni dia punya explanation. Yang panjang-panjang ni saya tak cerita ni, dia punya explanation ni. Boleh baca sendiri nanti ya. Okay. Anyway, please don't forget to fill in your attendance in the Google form, which I already embedded in the chat. Doktor, saya confused voluntary, involuntary. Siapa ni? Hasha, apa yang confuse voluntary involuntary tu?
Tak sure doktor, tapi macam confuse sikit.
Okay,
dua tu.
Alright. Anybody want to explain to Hasha? Anybody who understand want to try to explain to Hasha? Boleh tak tolong dia?
See the doctor.
Ke atas. Okay try my dear.
Voluntary is like the movement that we can control.
Contoh, bagi satu contoh. Aisyah tak faham.
Contoh berjalan. Saya nak berjalan ke bazar.
Asha, apa?
Saya lapar,
Asha.
saya lapar dan saya nak berjalan ke bazar. So saya berjalan ke bazar lah. Itu saya boleh kawal.
Betul, kalau awak lapar tu, awak boleh kontrol tak awak lapar? Masakan lapar tu.
Bolehlah, saya makanlah kalau saya lapar.
Awak makan tu baru awak boleh kontrol. Masa awak lapar tu, adakah awak boleh kontrol perasaan lapar tu?
Tak boleh.
Tak boleh.
Tak boleh. Kenapa awak tak boleh kontrol awak punya lapar?
Sebab apa ni?
Badan
kalau
sensor kan? Apa-apa je yang didetect oleh sensor dalam badan kita tu, visceral receptor dalam badan kita, contohnya awak lapar datang daripada mana? Daripada perut awak, betul tak? So that one is autonomic or we call it as the involuntary, benda yang tak boleh control. Contohnya dia lapar, dia nak pergi makan, dia ambil biskut tu dia makan, dia tak puas, dia lupa dia puasa hari ni, dia makan. So dia ambil, dia makan masuk mulut tu adalah benda yang dia boleh control. That one is voluntary. Faham tak Asha? Boleh Asha?
Ya, boleh boleh.
Okay.
Thank you, Rata.
Okay, alright. Ruben, the link is there in the chat box. Ada dapat tak Ruben? Any other questions?
Doctor, what is the greater splanchnic nerve and lesser splanchnic nerve?
Oh, okay. Splanchnic nerve tu is example of the nerve. When most of the nerve combine together forming a large nerve, we call it as the greater splanchnic nerve. If there are few only nerve that merge and form one cable, we call it as the lesser splanchnic nerve. Itu je. Okay, nanti awak baca lagi. Ada lagi tu detail tu. Kalau kita makan, tak ingat puasa, kira voluntary ke involuntary? Oh, ni sengaja makan. Okay. Ada. Awak jawablah soalan tu. Voluntary ke involuntary ke? Alright. Apa je kan saya cakap? Anything that control your skeletal muscle is voluntary. You boleh angkat tangan you nak pergi ambil benda tu makan. That one is voluntary. Involuntary tu benda yang you tak boleh control. Okay, boleh ya? Okay, anyway, I have something to do. Anyway, at 9:30. This one already 9:41. And I bet that you will have class at later. So, that's all for the class today. Thank you for your attendance and attention. If you have questions, please ask. But don't ask me what kind of questions gonna come up in your exam. Alright? Okay, thank you. Bye, see you again next time.
Thank you so much, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you,
Doctor. Thank you, Doctor.
Okay, you're welcome. Bye.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Doctor.